Welcome to Mutton Butt Tutorials. Greetings of the day. I am Sheshadri, faculty for Social Science. This session is for 10th grade ICSE. The subject is history, and we have already completed the lesson, the first war of independence, 1857, in two sessions. This is the question and answer session. Now, dear students, what I would like to emphasize before we start the actual questions is, in addition to what we have been discussing in our classes, you should also go through these two textbooks, which we have used in preparing this material. One textbook is by Modern Indian History and Civics for 10th ICSE. It is by Morning Star Publishers. The authors are Dolly Ellen and Irudaya Raj. You can note this down. One textbook is by Morning Star Publishers. The authors are Dolly Ellen and Irudaya Raj. The other textbook is by Avichal Publishing Company. And the authors are B.B. Dayal and A. Jacob. The other textbook is by Avichal Publishing Company. And the authors are B.B. Dayal and A. Jacob. Definitely, along with this material which we have discussed, you have to compulsorily go through these textbooks also. And whatever questions will appear in the exam will definitely be confined to this content that is there in what we have discussed, and it is in which is there in this textbooks. Now let us go through the questions. In the short questions, these are which are for 2 or 3 marks. 2 marks or 3 marks. So let us look at the questions now. This one, first one is, state any two political causes responsible for the first war of independence. Now, as we have discussed, the two important political causes were, one was the British policy of annexation of kingdoms under the pretext of inefficient administration of the rulers. They would say that it is being maladministrated and they would annex it. The second one was by doctrine of lapse. In doctrine of lapse, it said that the ruler who did not have a natural heir to his throne, he could not adopt a successor, his or her successor, without the permission of the British. And in such cases where the adoption was made, the territory would fall into hands of the British. So this was the doctrine of lapse introduced by Dalhousie, and which was highly resented by all the rulers. Now, second question, why did the doctrine of lapse become a political cause for the result of 1857? Now, according to the doctrine of lapse, if a king died without a heir to the throne, his adopted son could not succeed him. This territory would be annexed by the British, and this caused a lot of discontentment among the rulers as well as the ruled, as well as the people of the kingdom also. They were very unhappy with this British policy. Now, third question, mention any two social reforms advocated by the British, which affected the religious traditions of the people. Okay, there's a small error here in this Indian spelling. Please note that and correct it. The two social reforms advocated by the British, which affected religious tradition of the Indian people, were abolition of sati and widowry marriage. In sati, when the husband died, particularly among Rajputs, the wife was supposed to jump on to his funeral pyre and give up her life. I mean, she would be burnt alive. So it was a terrible practice, but it was, as per the culture of our country, this was being followed. Now the British made a law which abolished sati. Second one was widowry marriage. Any lady who would be widowed by death of her husband was not at all entitled to a normal life again. So British brought a rule which allowed widowry marriage. So these were the two social reforms by which Indians were affected, or the religious and cultural traditions of Indians were affected. Now, what was the General Service Enlistment Act? This was basically got to do with the army. In 1856, the General Service Enlistment Act was passed by the British Parliament. According to this act, Indian soldiers could be sent overseas. Now, the Brahmin soldiers saw in it a slander to their caste. Basically, during the culture of those days, it was prohibited for Brahmins to cross the ocean. It was believed that you will lose your caste itself if you cross the ocean. So that is why they were very unhappy with this particular rule. According to an accepted belief, it was considered a taboo for a Brahmin to cross the seas. This act disregarded the feeling of the Indian troops, which led to a feeling of resentment among them, and as a result, they were very angry with the British. State the immediate cause for the revolt of 1857. Now, the sepoys were ordered to use new Enfield rifles, the cartridges of which were greased with fat of cows and pigs. Basically, when they had to load the cartridge, they had to put it in their mouth and tear the paper. Now, both cow in the case of Hindus and pig in the case of Muslim is totally unacceptable. As we know, for the Hindus, the cow is very sacred, and if they were to literally touch the fat with their mouth, that was what they did not like. Similarly with Muslims, the pig, eating pig or eating pork is totally prohibited to Muslims, and they are any, because they consider the pig to be very unclean. Now, if pig fat was being used as the grease there, this is the Muslims, sepoys were very angry with this. In context, question 6, in context to the various factors responsible for causing the great upsurge of 1857, discuss about the introduction of railways and telegraphs. Now, both these items, railways as well as telegraphs, were actually a very good thing to happen to India. In fact, the first railway was started, the first railway line was started near Thane, in Bombay. And it was because of the railway line which started then, today we have a vast network of railways. Similarly, telegraphs, the communication became very fast with the introduction of telegraphs. But culturally, there were some rumors about this. For example, in telegraphs, the telegraph poles were thought to be erected for the purpose of hanging people on them who oppose the British rule. That's why people were all very worried when they saw these telegraph poles. Secondly, in railways. Now, in railways, in the railway compartments, Europeans had a different compartment and where Indians could not enter, and all Indians were in the other compartments. Now, in the Indian compartment, now Brahmins and untouchables were made to sit side by side, which was very much against the social custom prevailing in those days. Please remember, during those times, the caste system was very much prevalent. You had Brahmins, Rajput, Vaishyas, and Shudras. Now, if a Shudra would sit next to a person of a higher caste, a Brahmin, this was something the Brahmin would never accept. So, that is why they disliked the introduction of the railway here. Now, these modern innovations threatened the old social rules and produced unrest among many common orthodox people in India. Question 7. With reference to the British rule in India, mention two economic factors which became the causes of the First War of Independence, 1857. Now, the first factor here is the total ruin of the Indian textile and the handicraft industry because of the British trade policy. Whatever only raw materials were taken out from India, for example, cotton, which was grown here, was sent to the other countries. Whereas if any Indian textile finished product was exported to Britain, there the British government, they imposed a very high customs duty on Indian textiles because Indian textiles were very attractive and they were taking over the local market there. So they imposed customs duty of almost 80%, 60% to 80% on Indian textiles, which made it very costlier. And once the Indian textiles became costly, definitely their import was reduced, or export from India was reduced. Once export was reduced, that ruined the Indian textile industry. Similarly with handicrafts, for example, copperware or even earthenware, these things also which were made in India, when they went out, they were slapped with heavy customs duties. Now this resulted in their import into those countries becoming very less. So India lost out on this market, which ruined the life of the handicraft industry here. So this was one of the economic factors. The second one was exploitation of the farmers under the Jamindari system. Now, land revenues were high in the sense, even if there was a famine, even if there was no rainfall, and if there was even no produce on the land in that particular year, people still had to pay taxes, and these taxes were high. The moment somebody would not pay tax, they would eject the farmer from that land and they would annex that land directly to the East India Company. So this caused a lot of discontentment among cultivators. So you can write these two factors as the economic factors for the causes of the First War of Independence, 1857. With reference to the revolt of 1857, explain briefly about the British policy of racial discrimination. Racism was very much there during those times. And the British, they considered themselves racially superior to Indians. In the first place, educated Indians were not given appointment to high posts. And even if they entered the civil services, which is administrative services, IAS, IFS, IPS, all these services, when they enter, they could only raise up to a certain point. They could raise up to a post of a Sardar or an Amin, and that's it. They could not go any further. And in military service, the maximum an Indian could go was the rank of a subedar. So these people, the Indians were, they were not only hated by the British, definitely they faced a lot of humiliation. Indians faced a lot of humiliation in their own country. That's in our own country, Indians felt humiliated. So this was how racial discrimination was present. Now, question 9. The Great Rising of 1857 was an important event which produced far-reaching results. Explain the following with reference to the Great Uprising, the changes introduced in the administrative setup of the British territories. Now, in this administrative territory, here what was being discussed is the administrative setup with respect to the military. Now, the British realized that the ratio of Europeans and Indian sepoys in the army was a major factor. Like we had discussed in the lesson, in many regions, Europeans were not there at all. It was only full of Indian soldiers. So that is what also gave a lot of courage to the Indians to go into this mutiny, to go into this revolt. So now, after, as a consequence of the revolt, number of European troops was increased, and artillery and other weapons were placed under the Europeans only. Now, this heavy equipment and artillery, no Indian was allowed to use them. They were positions were not given to Indians at all. And to curb unity among the Indian troops, the new army was organized on division and counterpoise, means based on caste also. They were discriminating when they were making the army divisions. And a Royal Indian Army was created by merging the armies of the company and the crown together under a commander-in-chief. Earlier, it was only the East India Company. Now, they also had a combination of the British Army itself, which was under the Queen, under the crown, and also the soldiers from the East India Company. Now, the ratio of Europeans and Indians in the army was fixed at 1:2 in Bengal, that is 1 European to 2 Indians in Bengal, and 2:5 in Bombay and Madras. So they made sure that in every battalion or in every platoon, there were Europeans who would also keep an eye on any mutiny or any revolt that could happen, so that could totally be avoided. And Indian soldiers were excluded from artillery and arsenal departments. Now, the questions which we discussed so far were all 2 to 3 marks questions, which we have listed as short questions. Now, these long questions, they will come as 4 marks or even up to 5 marks questions. So, now, political causes in the short questions where we had given 2 points, here maybe you will need to give, say, 4 or 5 points that are there. Now, question 1, explain the political causes that led to the uprising of 1857. Now, among the political causes of the revolt, the chief factor was the doctrine of lapse. This policy deprived many kings of their kingdoms because they had no natural heir of their own, and since right of adoption in such cases was denied by the British, so the states automatically became a part of the British Empire. Now, in this case also the adopted heir, he could take the private property of the king, for example, his gold, his jewelry, whatever was like the private possession of the king, could go to the adopted person, but the territory, the land that was there in the kingdom, that would go to the British. So this was highly resented by the ruler as well as the Indians who were there in the kingdom. The other one was discourtesy of the Mughal emperors as Bahadur Shah was removed from Delhi's throne. They not only removed him from Delhi's throne, they also said that after Bahadur Shah Zafar, his family could not use the royal titles, and they were also instructed to move out of the Red Fort. The Red Fort at that time was the imperial palace. So this ill treatment of the Mughal emperor was also one of the reasons. Now, third one is the treatment meted out to Nana Saheb, as he was the adopted son of Peshwa Bajirao II. Because of the doctrine of lapse, he was refused pension, and because he was refused pension, he was sending emissaries to different parts of the country and traveling himself to gather support for the rebellion. And he fought very bravely. Of course, we have seen that in the event of the war itself, Nana Saheb fought greatly, but he was finally conquered by the British. Annexation of Awadh on grounds of misgovernance by Nawab Wajid Ali Shah. Now this was totally illogical. Their whole idea was to drive the to make just puppets out of the royal family, wherever their prince, all the princely families, and if they did not like a particular ruler for some reason or the other, they would say that the state was not being administered properly. Now, in the case of Awadh or Awadh, which was being governed under Nawab Wajid Ali Shah, they said that because of maladministration and your misgovernance, we are taking over the governance of Awadh. So this was also one of the reasons there. Now, unpopular administration, as the British officials were not easily approachable, and the language it was English, which was alien to the natives. Definitely at those times, Western education had just started. So, older people, the older generation, they were not educated at all in English. This became a hurdle. This became a big obstacle. Already they were very racist in their approach, and also because of communication problems, they would not be able to communicate properly in English. So, and the British officials had great contempt for Indians. One is because they think they were racially superior, also because they were not able to speak the language the way a Britisher would speak. Dear students, even today that is the case, but it is not our native language. But in those days, the kind of English medium education which we have today had just begun, it had just started. So this was also one of the points there. Now, question number two. The first war of independence of 1857 was the culmination of people's dissatisfaction with the British rule. In this context, discuss about the economic causes. So you will have to, this came has appeared partly in the other question also, short question also, there, here in the longer question. The first one was the British crippled Indian trade and created a high tariff wall in Britain against Indian goods and encouraged the imports of British goods to India. Like I said, you are creating a high tariff wall means you are simply slapping unreasonable customs duty on the item that you don't want to enter the country. So this particularly happened for Indian textiles and handicrafts. They purchased raw materials from India and manufactured goods were sent back to India, making enormous profit. So obviously, because manufactured goods for India from India became very expensive, their demand went down. And the cascading effect of that was here demand for Indian goods reduced and the handloom industry was very badly affected. This also had to do with Indian craftsmen and artisans. For example, Indian sculptures, Indian metalware, copperware, all these, they would make very good items of art. All this earlier was getting a very good market. And they were worried that their own goods would not have demand. So they increased the customs duty. And thus, once the demand came down, here thousands of craftsmen and artisans were thrown out of employment. Now, the British lost their prestige and honor by their defeat in the Afghan War. Of course, this was a negative point for the British. But here, annexation of South made soldiers lose their jobs. Similarly, in Jhansi, similarly in Kanpur also, whichever were the soldiers who were under the Indian ruler or king, they immediately, almost all of them lost their jobs. Almost, maybe barely a small percentage of the original soldier strength would also get absorbed when the East India Company took over. So many of thousands of these soldiers lost their jobs. And again, no credit was given to Indian soldiers for fighting various wars for the British Indian for the British. And we have seen this earlier, Indian soldiers were ill-treated and made to feel inferior. Correct the word there, it is not feel inferior, it is feel inferior. The duties of both British and Indian soldiers were the same. The Indian soldier could not rise above the rank of subedar, and for the same kind of duties, his salary was maybe even 1/4 of the salary which a Britisher would get. So this is also one of the reasons. And this is actually one of the, it's not exactly a economical reason, but it is a military reason. Numerical strength of the Indian soldiers was more than the British. This was one item which we have seen earlier, that after the War of Independence, they changed the composition of the soldiers to see that Europeans were there in every division of the army. Now here, because the numerical strength was more, it gave them the courage to fight against the British.
The next question, question number 3, the revolt of 1857 can be attributed to many causes. Explain the military causes which led to the revolt of 1857. The Indian sepoys in the British army had a strong sense of resentment at the low scale of salary and poor prospects of promotion. Duties were same for both Indian and British soldiers, but the Indian soldiers were getting only a small percentage of what the British soldier would get. So this brought about a strong sense of resentment. Now, in 1856, an act was passed under which every recruit was expected to serve overseas. The General Services Enlistment Act, where any soldier from the Indian Army would have to go overseas. Now, overseas travel was forbidden in the Hindu culture at that time. So this went against the Hindu religious beliefs at that time. Next point was, sipais were deprived of the allowances for bata when they served in territories other than their own. When a person is posted outside his home area, he was supposed to get an extra allowance. These allowances were not given to Indians. Then also it was their pent-up emotions burst forth when they were ordered to use the new Enfield rifles with cartridges greased with the fat of cows and pigs. This was, like we have discussed earlier, the primary reason. One of the primary reasons where the mutiny started. The British lost their prestige and honor by their defeat in the Afghan War. And annexation of Oudh made soldiers lose their jobs. This has come in the earlier economic causes also. It's also the military cause. Suddenly, soldiers were without jobs. And in the Afghan War, when the British lost the war, this encouraged the Indian soldiers, who till then thought the British were invincible. Now, this loss in the Afghan War gave strength to the Indian soldiers that the British army also could be defeated. No credit was given to Indian soldiers for fighting various wars for the British. When they were fighting the other wars, when they were in the South Asian region here, Indian soldiers were used, but they were never given any promotion for that. And Indian soldiers were ill-treated and made to feel inferior. Last factor here was the numerical strength of Indian soldiers was more than the British. In many areas in the army, there were very few or no British soldiers at all. Now, the absence of British soldiers, that gave the strength to the entire platoon or the entire battalion to raise against the British. Several factors led to the revolt of 1857. With reference to this, explain about the discontentment of sipais. This was also once come under the military causes, but this is especially with reference to the discontentment of sipais. Indian soldiers were unhappy because of their low salary and poor prospects of promotion and working conditions. All the high ranks in the army were reserved for the British only. The British officers maintained a social distance with Indian soldiers. They held a derogatory opinion about the soldiers and treated them like menial servants. They were very, racism was very rampant at that time, and they thought the Indians were of an inferior race. And they were therefore treated very badly. Also, the Hindu sipais of Bengal Army had to cross the Sindhu River during the Anglo-Afghan War, which was forbidden by religion. Once a person crosses a water body, a river or a sea, that would make him an outcast. That was the cultural thinking. So that is why the Hindu sipais were very angry with the British that they had to cross the river or they had to cross this huge water body. The immediate cause of discontentment among the sipais was the introduction of the Enfield rifles with cartridges, which were greased with the fat of cows and pigs. Now we know that for Hindus, the cow is very sacred, and in the case of Muslims, they regard the pigs as unclean. So the above factors together led to the feeling of discontentment among the sepoys, which proved instrumental in the sepoy mutiny of 1857. Discuss about the resentment of the native state against the British rulers. Which was the major factor of the 1857 revolt. The last Mughal emperor was Bahadur Shah. Lord Canning announced that Bahadur Shah's successor should not be used to allow the imperial title. Such a discourtesy to the Mughal emperor, this hurt the Muslim sentiments considerably. Because they almost ended the Mughal emperor's rule. And Dalhousie's refusal to grant pension to Nana Saheb, the adopted son of ex-Peshwa, was resented by the Hindus in general and Nana Saheb in particular, because they applied the doctrine of lapse here, saying a ruler who did not have a natural heir could not adopt his sons or successors. Annexation of Awadh. Nawab Wazid Ali Shah was deposed on the ground that Awadh was not being managed well. The annexation of Awadh was a case of high-handedness on part of the company. The Nawab of Awadh had been loyal to the company for a long time. The British broke all their pledges and promises to the native rulers. This caused resentment among the rulers. By this, we come to the end of the long questions. I have also, I'll also be giving an assignment in the ButtonBud app, mobile app. So you will have to answer those questions also. Any doubts, please call us on these numbers or you can send a message on the ButtonBud Tutorials mobile app chat section. Thank you.